Over the session to Dr. Siddharth Jain, today I got an opportunity to have a brief introduction of sir. Sir has been completed his MD physicians in 2012 and then completed MD-DM nephrology from IKDRC Ahmedabad, sir. After that, he has been associated with various hospitals and having total 10 years of experience in nephrology, sir. And as far as that accomplishment concern, he has been established and his change in dialysis unit in Unity, Greenleaf, TriStar, as well as PP Samani Hospital in Surat. Sir has been having a merriment acknowledgement with having Golden Feather, that Times Health Icon Award in 2019 for the best nephrology in South Gujarat, sir. Even he has been contributing an author in a book titled Case-Based Approach in Hypertension Management. Moreover, sir has been associated and member of many bodies like Indian Society of Nephrology, Association of Physicians, Indian Society of Organ Transplant, as well as ISCCM, sir. So it is a pleasure to be have with you, sir. And today, yes, another one great opportunity to share your views with the doctors as an audience of South Gujarat, sir. So with this, I hand over the session to Dr. Siddharth Jain. Yeah, you can start to share your slides, sir.
Okay. So I think slides are visible.
Yeah, absolutely, sir.
Okay. So good evening, all of you. So today we are going to discuss about resistant hypertension. As all of us in our clinical day-to-day practice sees a lot of patients of hypertension, and it's a very common thing. And resistant hypertension, I think all of us encounter day in and day out. So we'll just try to have a discussion regarding some practical aspects. So we all know that kidneys and hypertension are having strong links. As Sir Arthan Guyton stated, that kidney is involved in the genesis of any type of hypertension, and kidney plays a vital role in long-term blood pressure control. This was proved by cross-experimental theory, in which when kidney from a normotensive rat was transplanted into hypertensive rat after having native bilateral nephrectomy, then his hypertensive rat will become normotension, and vice versa. That is, if the kidneys from the hypertensive rat is transplanted into normotensive rat, that normotensive rat will become hypertensive. So this proves regarding the genesis or origin of hypertension in the kidneys. So today we will try to discuss and understand these few commonly used terms, like what is essential hypertension, uncontrolled hypertension, pseudo-resistant hypertension, resistant hypertension, secondary hypertension, renovascular hypertension. So before actually coming to actual topic, let us have quick revision regarding the BP measurement technique. So ideally sitting and supine standing, both BP should be taken on contralateral limbs. Ideally, two readings, 5 minutes apart, should be taken. And after rest, preferably same time of the day. Standard BP cuff, we all know, 12 into 26 centimeter, whereas in the obese patient, it's 13 into 36 centimeter. Calibration of instrument has to be done time to time. BP cuff should encircle about 80% of the arm with a thin clothing below it. And both patient and doctor should be relaxed. There should not be any smoking, alcohol, or caffeine by the patient. These are very, very small points, but these are very, very important to have accurate measurement of blood pressure. Coming to target, we all know about GNC7, and not getting confused, we keeping very, very simple that in general, target for blood pressure control has to be 140 by 90 or less. However, if the patient is diabetic or CKD, recommended target for blood pressure is 130 by 80 or less. So it's very, very simple. Now, coming to today's topic regarding what is resistant hypertension. So resistant hypertension is defined when blood pressure is not on target, that is 140 by 90 or 130 by 80 in a diabetic or hypertensive patient with use of three drugs, three antihypertensive drugs, one of which is diuretic and at an optimal dosage in a compliant patient on lifestyle changes. So this is a basic definition of resistant hypertension. Blood pressure not on target with use of three drugs, one of which is diuretic at an optimal dosage. So this is resistant hypertension. This definition does not apply to patient who has been just recently diagnosed to have hypertension. Moreover, resistant hypertension is not synonym with uncontrolled hypertension. Uncontrolled hypertension includes all other categories of patients who are receiving inadequate treatment, who are having poor adherence, who are having undetected secondary hypertension, as well as those with true treatment resistant. So resistant hypertension does not include uncontrolled hypertension. Coming to prevalence of resistant hypertension, in general population, prevalence is low. However, in specialized clinic, like in our nephrology clinic, up to 15% may be having resistant hypertension. In clinical trials like ALHART, CONVINCE, LIFE, etc., up to 30% of the patients were having resistant hypertension. So resistant hypertension, we come to the causes. So as such, the true resistant hypertensions are very, very low. So if we search or try to adequately investigate, then we can found some cause of resistant hypertension in so many patients. Like about 50% were in one of the studies published in 2003, 50% of the patients of resistant hypertension were having drug-related causes. Which drugs, common drugs, we will just discuss further. 1% were having use of interference substance, 5% were having secondary hypertension. Again, we will discuss it in further slides. Secondary hypertension, very, very important to identify and diagnose. Why? Because it is treatable. Once we identify and diagnose, we treat that, then we get a good results. Patient's blood pressure comes down and requirement of antihypertensive also decreases. Then non-adherence was found in about 16% and few other psychological causes, etc. Message is that true resistant hypertension is still very, very less. So we have to differentiate from resistant hypertension to pseudo-resistant hypertension. What is pseudo-resistant hypertension? Pseudo-resistant hypertension due to poor BP techniques, not measuring BP properly, poor adherence. We are thinking that patient's blood pressure is not controlled, but there is a poor adherence to the ongoing medication. White coat effect. We all know regarding the white coat hypertension, in which clinic blood pressures are always high because patient is tense. However, in his home environment, relaxed environment, his blood pressure remains normal. Lack of treatment or under treatment. So, differentiate resistant hypertension from pseudo-resistant hypertension with the causes we have just discussed. Improper blood pressure techniques. Whenever in elderly patient there was highly calcified vessels, we have pseudo-resistant hypertension, white coat effect, poor patient adherence. That is very, very important, especially in our Indian scenario. We have to be very, very important to see regarding the patient adherence. We have to see for the side effect of medication, complicated dosing schedule sometimes leads to poor adherence, poor relationship between doctor and patient, inadequate patient education. Again, I will just like to spend few seconds. It is a very, very important that whenever any patient comes to us first time detected hypertension, we have to take some time to explain regarding the long-term morbidity and mortality. Patient comes to us, we measure BP and patient says, ke, this is the regular BP for a long time, like 160, 80, ke BP hamesha atluj rahe. So again, we have to explain to patient regarding the importance of good control of blood pressure. Then it may be related to antihypertensive medications in an adequate doses and sometimes physician inertia, failure to change or increase dose regime when not at good. So a very important technique or very important tool to distinguish between white coat pseudo-resistant hypertension is home blood pressure monitoring and ambulatory blood pressure monitoring. So I will advise all my friends, all my patients, whenever we are suspecting that blood pressure is actually not under good control, patient is having resistant hypertension, then we need to rule out white coat hypertension, and best thing is to have 24 hours ambulatory blood pressure monitoring or home blood pressure monitoring. So we have just discussed in one of the study about 50% patients were having drug interactions. So what are the common medications which patients use in day-to-day life which interacts with blood pressure control? So very, very important and common is NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, even selective COX inhibitors. Sympathomimetic agents like decongestants, we all know now phenylpropylamine has been banned by government agencies because of the risk of severe hypertension and cases of ICH. Then drug abuse like cocaine, ephedrine, diet pills, stimulants, alcohol, binge drinking, the intake of alcohol more than 30 ml per day. In females, use of oral contraceptive pills. In our kidney patients, use of cyclosporine, erythropoietins, use of recal and herbal compound. So all these are the list of medications, and it is common. It's not uncommon. Whenever we are having resistant hypertension, uncontrolled hypertension, we need to take history. We need to ask patients whether patient is taking any of this drug which can interact with BP medication and control of blood pressure. So coming to genetics and resistant hypertension, mostly polygenic. So ENaC mutations in Liddle syndrome, mutation of CYP3A5 enzymes, ACE2 gene mutations, which is most established causing resistant hypertension. So what are the other causes of resistant hypertension? Patient-related causes like high sodium intake, poor adherence to treatment, intake of drugs that raises BP. We have already discussed all these things, lack of lifestyle adherence. Other factors such as subclinical volume overload, inadequate use of diuretics, progressive renal insufficiency, unsuspected secondary cause. These are the other causes. So there are some strong associates of resistant hypertension, like type 2 DM, having HbA1c of more than 9. Similarly, chronic kidney disease, having creatinine more than 1.5. Obstructive sleep apnea, having AHI more than 20. And left ventricular hypertrophy, BMI more than 30. These are the associates. Any patients, any group of patients having any of these associates, more chances of having uncontrolled or resistant hypertension. So we can see that out of all hypertension in like trials, there were 30% of the patients were having resistant hypertension. And if we search properly, then up to 5% we may get caused as having secondary hypertension. So whom we should watch for, or we should try to search for secondary hypertension? So young hypertensive patients, yes, we should try to search for secondary hypertension. First time detected hypertension in elderly more than 60 years, we should try your search for secondary hypertension. And patients who are previously having good control of blood pressure, now suddenly blood pressure goes out of control, we should search for secondary hypertension. So what are the common causes of secondary hypertension? We will not discuss serious thing, but common things which is easily detectable: primary hyperaldosteronism, pheochromocytoma, Cushing syndrome, renal artery stenosis, and renal diseases. These are the common causes of secondary hypertension. So prevalence of secondary hypertension, is found in about 5 to 7% of the patients, in which 3 to 5% having renal hypertension, which include renal vascular and renal parenchymal. Some are having endocrine causes like Cone syndrome, Cushing syndrome, pheochromocytoma, use of ocipills and miscellaneous. So coming to renal causes of secondary hypertension, is divided into renal vascular and renal parenchymal. Renal vascular hypertension means secondary to renal artery stenosis. Renal artery stenosis can be atherosclerotic, or it can be due to fibromuscular dysplasia. Other rare causes are arthritis, dissection, thrombosis, Takayasu's syndrome. Renal parenchymal hypertension is secondary to the chronic kidney disease. It may be unilateral due to reflux or tumor, or it may be due to bilateral like chronic glomerulonephritis, chronic pyelonephritis, autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease, or renin secreting tumors. So we have talked about renal artery stenosis. So we must be aware regarding the fibromuscular dysplasia, in which there is affection of tunica media. It is usually present in young females. It has a good response to angioplasty, and one of the cause may be Takayasu's arteritis. It is found in about 10% of patients. However, 90% of the patients of renal artery stenosis are due to atherosclerotic, and it is found in elderly patients, more in males, smokers, and severe recent hypertension. There may be history of flash pulmonary edema, and these patients worsens after use of ACE inhibitors or ARB. So renal artery stenosis, which we have already discussed, 90% cases are due to atherosclerosis, 10% are due to fibromuscular. Diagnosis is by duplex ultrasonography or CT renal angio is the gold standard. MR angio is also very, very highly sensitive. Whenever we are having patients with altered creatinine, we cannot perform CT renal angio with contrast, then MR angio can be done without contrast with a very good sensitive. 50% of the patients undergoing coronary angiography are found to have asymptomatic renal artery stenosis. Renal revascularization with stenting is the treatment of choice. However, there are a lot of debate regarding this, and it requires certain patient selection criteria. This is a figure showing a bedded appearance, fibromuscular dysplasia giving rise to renal artery stenosis, and after intervention, after balloon angioplasty, so this renal artery is opened. And what is the beauty? Beauty is that whenever we treat these patients, their antihypertensive requirement goes drastically low. Like patients who are on 3 or 4 antihypertensive would be required single antihypertensive. This is the appearance of renal artery stenosis secondary to atherosclerosis. And again, after opening with the balloon angioplasty and stenting. Coming to renal parenchymal, that was renal vascular hypertension. Coming to renal parenchymal hypertension, CKD is a common cause and complication. Serum creatinine more than 1.5, so many times associated with renal parenchymal hypertension. It is due to increased sodium and fluid retention, expansion of intravascular volume, and it is a strong predictor of poor outcomes. So what are the other causes of secondary hypertension? Adrenal causes, it can cause hypertension due to excess mineralocorticoid, excess glucocorticoid, or excess catecholamines. Excess mineralocorticoid in case of primary hyperaldosteronism, in case of glucocorticoid, remediable hyperaldosteronism, in case of 11-beta-deoxydeficiency or hyperdeoxycorticosis. Excess glucocorticoid secretion in case of primary increase in cortisol like Cushing's disease or Cushing's syndrome. Excess catecholamines in case of pheochromocytoma. So we will just discuss shortly regarding primary aldosteronism. This suppression of renin activity, low magnesium, low calcium, low potassium, and metabolic alkalosis. So again, this is a very, very common and not very common, but very like a clinching diagnosis. Whenever we are patient having a very high blood pressure with hypokalemia and metabolic alkalosis, then we have to keep in mind regarding the possibility of primary aldosteronism. How we can confirm by higher 24-hour urinary aldosterone, or more common, more easy test is serum aldosterone level. And we have to do MRI to locate that, and treatment like medical treatment, those patients who cannot afford, who are not candidate for surgery, then mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist. However, definitive treatment is surgical treatment, that is laparoscopic adrenalectomy. So again, this is something which is treatable. So any patients with resistant hypertension with metabolic alkalosis and hypokalemia, we have to check for serum aldosterone level, and we have to check for MRI adrenals to look for primary hyperaldosteronism. Secondary, Cushing syndrome. So excessive ACTH by pituitary adenoma or cortisol from adrenal adenoma or carcinoma give rise to Cushing syndrome or Cushing's disease due to ectopic ACTH secretion. 78 to 80% of the patients with Cushing's syndrome have resistant hypertension, diabetes, and OSA may be contributed. Target end organ damage is more, and surgical excision of ACTH or cortisol producing tumor is the treatment of choice. So again, we have to identify this disorder. Coming to pheochromocytoma, again, classical history, patients giving history of episodic hypertension. Suddenly, there is a sense of impending doom, palpitation, headache, sweatings, and very important, very sensitive test is free plasma metanephrine measurement, which is almost 99% sensitivity and 89% specificity in diagnosis pheochromocytoma. Again, the treatment is laparoscopic removal. So other causes of secondary hypertension, coarctation, PAN, aortoarthritis, obstructive sleep apnea, Liddle syndromes, acromegaly, hyperthyroidism, very important, exogenous like prolonged use of external affair, exogenous glucocorticoids, that is heterogenic Cushing syndrome, excess liquor use, excess alcohol, and drugs, we have already discussed. So this was the, in short, regarding secondary hypertension. So evaluation of resistant hypertension, we have already discussed regarding good blood pressure measurement technique, strict compliance with treatment recommendation, evaluation of secondary cause, we have just discussed ambulatory blood pressure monitoring, very important to exclude white coat hypertension, assessment of target end organ damage like serum creatinine for CKD, fundoscopy for retinopathy, 2D echo for LVH, history of drug intake, very, very important, history of daytime sleepiness, loud snoring, apneic spell to make diagnosis of OSA, obstructive sleep apnea. Then we can have angiography, MRI, CT, nuclear medicine to evaluate renal vascular or renal hypertension. So this is a busy slide, but I would like to make it simple regarding the step-by-step evaluation management of patients appearing to have secondary resistant hypertension. We have to be familiar and most common with most common hypertension guideline. We have to identify and reverse pseudo resistant hypertension. We have to exclude white coat hypertension by 24-hour ambulatory blood pressure monitoring. We have to evaluate patient's adherence. Then we have to have close follow-up. We have to identify and risk factors, like specifically ask patient about the use of pharmacological agents or any drug which increases blood pressure. Medication list we have already seen. We have to ask regarding the use of alcohol, regarding dietary salt. We have to assess regarding the obesity. We have to evaluate regarding the renal functions. We have to perform thorough search to find out any secondary cause of hypertension. We have to treat aggressively with optimal dose of the antihypertensive drugs, or we can refer that patient to hypertension clinic specialist. So coming to principles of treatment, lifestyle principles, we all know regarding salt restriction, very important, less than 2 grams per day, weight loss, physical activity, smoke cessation resistance, and glycemic and lipid control. Coming to drug treatment of resistant hypertension, if a correctable cause is found, we have to treat that aggressive drug therapy, effective diuresis, use of furosemide in a BD dose, torsemide in an OD dose, mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists like spironolactone, trimetron, hydralazine, that is second direct vasodilator, hydralazine or minocycline, minoxidil with beta blocker and a diuretics. So we'll just talk regarding the antihypertensive drug resistant. One of the very important thing is rifampicin. So in our CKD patients, so many times detected to have COX, and when we start AKT, we see that the blood pressure increasing. So rifampicin is a very, very common enzyme inducer. And what we happen then when we start rifampicin by inducing enzymes, the so many antihypertensive drugs get degenerative. So the patient's blood pressure increases. Similarly, use of TCA, less used now, again, a very commonly used drug like indomethacin. This is a PG inhibitors. And when we use with AC inhibitors, again, interaction and the blood pressure rises. Cocaine, phenylpropylamine, we have already discussed, it has been banned now. So again, these are common drug interactions. So what is the additional agent we can add and what combination we do use? So diuretics, it has been frequently observed that inappropriate volume expansion contributing to the treatment assistance, such as diuretic, is essential to maximize BP control. In most of the patient, use of long-acting thiazide diuretic will be effective. However, it has been seen in trials that clothalidone is superior in efficacy as compared to hydrochlorothiazide. So clothalidone should be preferentially used in patients with resistant hypertension. However, in patients with more edema or patients with CKD having eGFR less than 30, hydrochlorothiazide use of drugs is usually ineffective. Loop diuretics like furosemide or torsemide may be required and often in a higher dose. Then mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, again, there has been consistent in reports that high prevalence of primary aldosteronism in patients with resistant hypertension. So MR receptor antagonist provides significant antihypertensive benefit when added to existing multi-drug regimens. So we are having spironolactone, most commonly used. Then eplerenone is the like newer spironolactone can be used with a dose of 25 to 50 mg per day. Additional benefits are anti-proteinuric defect, improves heart failure. However, 10% of the patients develop gynecomastia, and we cannot use when the patient is having serum creatinine of more than 2.5 or potassium of more than 5 because of risk of hyperkalemia. Then direct vasodilators like hydralazine, minoxidil, we can use. It is usually used with beta blocker and a diuretic, and many times patients will have headache and fluid retention due to direct vasodilator. Alpha adrenergic blocker, they are not used as monotherapy. They can be used as add-on therapy. They can cause urinary incontinence, especially in female, due to bladder outlet relaxation. Future options for resistant hypertensions like direct renin inhibitors, neutral endopeptidase inhibitors, newer aldosterone antagonists, aldosterone synthesis inhibitors, all these are in pipelines. Non-pharmacological approach, these are surgical approach and permanent approach like implantable pulse generator in perivascular carotid sinus leads to surgically implanted renal denervation. Against lots of debates are ongoing, neurovascular decompression. So coming to conclusion, we have to evaluate and differentiate primary hypertension, resistant hypertension from pseudo-resistant hypertension. We have to rule out white coat hypertension, non-adherence. We have to look for secondary hypertension, common causes, few Cushing's, hyperaldosteronism. We have to see for the drug history, diet history, renal functions, ambulatory blood pressure monitoring. We can use clothalidone, add spironolactone. We can use direct vasodilators like hydralazine, minoxidil, can consider alpha blocker. Loop diuretic may be required, often in a higher dose. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much for your lucid presentation, sir. My request to audience, please, any question you can have on chat box. Later on, we will have that interactions. And now I have been invited Dr. Apurva Vasavada, sir. And before he proceed for his presentations, I would like to have some brief introductions of him, sir. Right, sir. Actually, sir, no need to have any further introductions. He's been right now associated with all major corporate hospital, mainly TriStar, and he's having his own consulting at Kashi Plaza, Sir Hriday Clinic. About sir, having an experience of more than 25, 26 years, and having his DM cardiology from prestigious Grant Medical College, Mumbai. He has been having a very vast experience in coronary angioplasties, permanent pacemakers, pediatric balloon interventions, critical neonates interventions, as well as ASD and PDA device closure. So, yes, sir. With this, I request Dr. Apurva Vasavada, sir, to have the sessions. And it has been a pleasure to see you on this dais, sir. Sir, dais is yours, sir. Please.
Thanks a lot. Good evening, everyone. Reading down the participant list of almost 60 means still people are not fed up of webinars. That is a great news.
Sir, right now 72, more than 72, sir. 72,
okay.
Right, sir.
Share my screen. Let us see if it goes well.
Right, sir.
That's it. So I've been given the topic regarding beta blockers in heart failure, which is most of it is old wine, and even new bottles cannot be found for it. But let us begin. Aristotle was the first one to realize, surprisingly, that life begins.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. Your slide has been yet not visible, sir.
Not visible? Okay.
Yes.
Now,
right, sir. It started to sharing. Yes, sir. It's visible. You can do full screen, sir. Yeah.
What?
Yes, sir. It's absolutely okay, sir.
Aristotle was surprisingly the first one to make the statement that life begins with first heartbeat and ends with the last one. Very obvious. Probably those they didn't know about it. The history of beta blockers is, before going into this, I'll have some anecdote or rather some studies about what is the importance of heart rate in a animal or mammal which has got a circulatory system. There is data that the total number of heartbeats in the lifetime of a particular mammal is fixed, and across the smallest to largest mammals, it is the same number of heartbeats almost for a lifetime. And the average life of a shrew, which is a 2 kilo weight small mouse like mammal, the heart rate is very fast, and the average length of survival is around 2 to 3 years. And you compare that with a whale, which is a huge animal, mammal, and their circulatory system, the whale survives over up to 150 years. And both these have got the heart rate number of beats in an average lifetime almost the same, right? Because the smaller animals have got faster metabolism and faster heart rate. The larger animals have slower metabolism, slower heart rate, but the total number of beats is same. Human beings also fall on the same logarithmic curve. The problem is that because of development of medical science and change in the lifestyle, human beings have more moved to the right of the curve. Otherwise, they also fall in the same level. So that means that your number of beats in your lifetime are probably fixed right from the beginning. And that's why it is important that the resting heart rate has to be slower. And that's why beta blockers come into play. So they were first developed by Sir James Black, who ultimately got a Nobel Prize for the same. Beta blockers tend to act at various sites. These claims are probably rather too many, probably, because they don't much affect the risk factors as such. Hypertension also, there is a question mark regarding their role. They don't affect directly atherosclerosis. LVH they affect to a certain extent. But once it comes to coronary heart disease, myocardial ischemia is treated by the beta blockers. Coronary thrombosis is, once it happens, immediately it has no role to play. But in early stage of coronary thrombotic patients, there is a lot of role to play in acute coronary syndrome. And same for myocardial infarction. Also, it has got a tremendous role to play in various atrial and ventricular arrhythmias and prevention of sudden death, where it is one of the leading molecules. And on the long run, it affects the cardiac remodeling and the ventricle enlargement, and it improves the prognosis of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. Although there is no impact proven on the heart failure of other kind, that is of mid-range or preserved ejection fraction. And ultimately, at these sites, if it is given optimally, it affects the mortality, it prolongs the survival to a certain extent. It acts by acting against the neurohormonal activation which goes on in many of these diseases. If you consider heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, which is a major issue for most of our physicians, and with the aging population and with the treatments available for acute coronary syndrome and rheumatic heart disease, which are the two main reasons for cardiac dysfunction in our population, there are more and more people surviving with heart failure and reduced ejection fraction. And therefore, everybody has to treat these patients for a long time. And we should try to improve not only the symptoms, but the prognosis of these patients and probably, hopefully, the survival. And the four known pillars of the therapy are the ACE inhibitor ARB, which is gradually being replaced by the ARNI, the combination with a naproxen inhibitor. Beta blocker, for now, it is established mainline treatment for almost now two or more decades. MRA, that is eplerenone or spironolactone, is also a major pillar of therapy once the EF is less than 35% and patient is having class 3 symptoms or more. So these are the molecules to be used routinely. These are called guideline directed medical therapies, which have got impact on the prognosis as well as the remodeling of the heart in HF-REF. And so in stage C heart failure reduced ejection fraction, stage C means symptomatic patients. That is not only structural changes of the heart, but there are actual symptoms. The ejection fraction is clearly less than 40%. That is called HF-REF. The magnitude of benefit demonstrated by RCTs in all of these molecules, ACE and ARBs basically mortality reduction by 17%, beta blockers by almost 35%, MRAs in class 3 NYHA patient less than EF 35, a 30% reduction in mortality. Even hydralazine nitrate, this is a surprising thing for me also. I'm not very sure about this statistic, but here they say 40% reduction in mortality. The number needed to treat, which is very important figure for the efficacy of the molecule. And for ACE inhibitor, it's 26. For beta blockers, it is 9. MRA is even lower. ARNI has got a further impact that over and above the reduction of mortality caused by ACE inhibitor, further 20% reduction is done by the ARNI when compared to ACE inhibitor. And the other important parameter which you have to look for in efficacy of the drugs is the reduction of recurrent heart failure hospitalization, which is very important, not only from economic point of view for the patient, but it is direct impact on the prognosis, because more number of hospitalization every time there is increase in mortality by around 15% over the next 3 to 6 months. So repeated hospitalizations are not good. And therefore, all these three drugs also prevent the hospitalization by 30 to 40%. So that way they are important drugs, and preferably in all of these patients, you should try to achieve the maximum tolerated dose of all the three types of molecules as far as possible. Concerning the beta blocker use in hypertension per se, because hypertension is a major risk factor for most of these diseases, especially for HFPF, but also to a certain extent for HFREF. And it has been shown that beta blockers are not very useful in established vascular disease and elderly patient, but younger patients where resting heart rate is fast and where the circulating volume is high, then in those patients, they are still having a role to play. So although they have been removed from step one treatment for most of the hypertension, still in younger patients, they are still applicable. And of course, with presence of comorbidities like ischemia or coronary syndromes, they are going to play a role. Same way for comorbidity like reduced ejection fraction, they are still going to play a role. Now, for heart failure with REF, reduced ejection fraction, which are the beta blockers which actually work? There are plenty of beta blockers, starting from propranolol. There are a variety of them with or without selectivity for beta 1 receptor, with or without vasodilator effect, with or without intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. But the three beta blockers which are clearly proven, the first one to be studied were, of course, metoprolol. But it did not establish very fast because the studies were coming from Europe and they were not large enough. Then there were studies in from US where they studied carvedilol, which is a non-selective vasodilatory beta blocker. And there were a lot of good results from the initial studies. Bisoprolol also gave similar results. And all three can improve the overall event-free survival as well as mortality in patients who are having NYHA class 2 or 3 heart failure. For those who are class 4 heart failure, you have to bring them back to ambulatory class 4 or class 3 before you actually have an impact, because these are advanced disease and still they have got impact, but you have to switch them back to class 3 by doing other therapies. Other beta blockers like atenolol, which is the cheaper one, propranolol, which is the oldest one, are not tested and they should not be used because they are not proven to be useful because of certain reasons. Four beta blockers have been shown to be useful, out of which bisoprolol, carvedilol, and metoprolol, they reduce mortality in HFREF, they reduce sudden cardiac death, they reduce the progression of the heart failure to a certain extent, especially the metoprolol has been proven, and NYHA class improvement is there with bisoprolol. But nebivolol doesn't have most of these effects. The study which was done found to be having marginal effects, although the total all encompassing endpoint was effective. So nebivolol is not much used in these patient HFREF, but the other three are commonly used. So in patients HFREF, what are the medications indicated as such? Those who are no CKD and those who have abnormal renal function, beta blockers are indicated in both, of course, but you have to be careful if there is significant renal dysfunction. The preferred beta blocker is metoprolol, although you can also safely use the safely use the sorry, the slides are jumping. Just a moment. How do you go back on the slides? This is going forward.
Sir, back arrow key you can use.
Yes.
Right, sir. Yeah.
So, the medications are indeed beta blockers. If there is a significant renal dysfunction, then you should prefer metoprolol or bisoprolol. Carvedilol is not to be preferred. Atenolol, for any other reason you are using, should be absolutely avoided because it is major clearance to the kidney. Otherwise, you can use them. For asymmetric ARBs, of course, in renal dysfunction, you have to be extra careful. But in patients with microalbuminuria because of glomerulopathy, they are actually having benefit. Only thing, you have to be extra careful and monitor closely. And sometimes you have to stop them if the creatine worsens. MRAs, again, can be used in both, but you have to be careful regarding potassium. And with a severe renal dysfunction, the effect may be significantly less compared to those with a good renal function. Diuretics, of course, as a symptomatic treatment to be used in both, you will require much higher doses in CKD. Digoxin can be used in both only for those patients who are symptomatic despite all these therapies, also including ubiquitin and ARNI. And still they are symptomatic, or if the patient is having AF or very fast heart rate despite all these drugs, you can use digoxin, but you have to be careful. It has only got symptom related role, no prognostic benefit, probably prognostic harm if you are not using it carefully and giving too much dose. So in coronary artery disease, heart failure, everywhere this is used. So cardiac disease with heart failure and reduced ejection fraction, beta blockers reduce the mortality, reduce hospitalization. They are to be used widely and in almost every patient. With MR, EF, or with preserved EF, there is insufficient data. You are using beta blockers only to reduce the heart rate in these patients. But new data coming in is that reducing the heart rate too much to below 80 is also not beneficial. So there is a target range of heart rate between 80 and 90 for these patients. Till now, we used to go to lower the better, but that is not so. And so there is not enough data to support use of beta blockers as a disease modifying agent. In fact, there is no drug which is proven to be modifying the course of this disease. So treatment right now remains empirical and symptomatic basically for HF, MREF and HF, PEF. Post-acute coronary syndrome is a different ballgame altogether. Immediate effect, early beta blocker, once the patient is stable hemodynamically and not in a class 3 or class 4 status, is it reduces the mortality, reduces the reinfarction. And at the same time, if you are giving too early in a patient who is basically the heart stroke output is reduced and the cardiac output is dependent on the heart rate. In such patients, if you give beta blocker in too much of a hurry, especially in the first 24 to 48 hours, without actually confirming the proper situation, it can cut off the heart rate protective mechanism and it can cause cardiac shock. So the problem with using early beta blockers in acute myocardial infarction and severe acute coronary syndromes is that although it reduces the heart failure incidence by 5%, reduces the sudden death by 5%, but increases the cardiogenic shock by 10 to 11%. It balances off. So very early use of beta blocker in acute coronary syndromes is to be avoided. But of course, preferably before the patient is discharged, patient should be on beta blocker unless there is a severe contraindication. The long-term effect also after ACS is to reduce mortality. Of course, with reperfusion early, like a primary angioplasty or an early CABG, and if the pumping recovers, then once the post-ACS cardiac pump function is more than 40% EF, then probably beta blockers don't have much role to play either in mortality or morbidity. So there, then you will only use for heart rate control if the patient is still ischemic, but there is no prognostic impact. And in stable coronary artery disease without recent acute coronary syndrome and with a relatively normal EF that is above 40%, there is not much data that it has got any prognostic impact, but it can be used for symptomatic angina. It can be used for angina equivalent patients. It can also be used for a patient who is asymptomatic but documented significant silent ischemia. But otherwise, there is no long-term prognostic impact of beta blockers in these patients. In heart failure, the introduction of beta blocker, it actually started in 75 to 79. First reports came with metoprolol from Sweden. I can remember that when I was studying DM, this used to be a new thing. And when I started practice, none of these beta blockers are available. Only metoprolol was available. That too, used to get a 25 milligram tablet and break them into small four sizes or crush them and divide. Give 6.25, but that was also not metoprolol succinate. That was metoprolol tartrate. Succinate came on later on, and the data which is available is all with metoprolol succinate. Then came carvedilol and bisoprolol, which are more frequently being used nowadays. And by late 90s, the beta blockers had established. And now, after 25 years or so, it is a well-established treatment. But still, unfortunately, only 40 to 50% of the patients, or maybe even less, are actually receiving the optimal use of beta blocker in HFrEF. So we have to correct that, because it has got tremendous impact on the long-term mortality. Which block beta blocker and which dose? Well, most of you know this, but bisoprolol starting dose should be 1.25, and you can build up over a follow-up of 2 to 3 weeks. And looking at the BP, fall in BP, urine output, patient symptomaticity, congestive state, and the heart rate response. And target should be maximum 10 milligram per day. Initially, you can start BD dose to avoid an immediate effect on the cardiac output. But later on, once established and safe, you can go to 10 milligram OD dose or maybe 5 milligram OD. The target should be getting the rate down to maybe around 60, 65 if possible. And on routine moderate activity like walking around, say, 100 paces or climbing 2 flights or 4 flights of stairs, the rate should not rise beyond 90 to 100. That is the target of treatment. The same for metoprolol succinate or metoprolol long release, starting with 12.5 BD and then reaching up to 100 BD, that is the maximum dose. This is a fixed BD dose. You cannot give it OD. Carvedilol, again, is a fixed BD dose, but you can go up to 25 BD from starting from 3.125. Nebivolol is described here, but not a preferred drug for HFrEF. They are not a homogeneous group of drugs. So depending on the molecule, the potency and duration of action is different. Cardioselectivity is different. ISA is different, and lipid solubility is different. And the selectivity and vasodilation property will be decided by the beta blocker class. And accordingly, there will be side effect, metabolic profile, as well as efficacy. Although efficacy, there are not many differences found out for the three molecules we are talking about for HFrEF. But beta 1 selectivity here is propranolol as minimal in place, but atenolol as higher, and bisoprolol is one of the highest selectivity, almost comparable. Nebivolol also has a similar very high selectivity. So considering the three molecules which we are talking about, beta 1 selectivity is maximum with bisoprolol. So if the patient has got active airway problem, active, I'm talking about not a well-controlled COPD, but a labile asthmatic bronchitis or actual asthma, this patient you can avoid beta blocker. But once the patient is settled, even in COPD patients, when there is indication for beta blocker for cardiovascular reason, actually it reduces mortality. So you should use beta blocker, although carefully. Now, if you see the beta 1 selectivity, so this we already described, the cost is more or less similar for carvedilol and beta and bisoprolol. Probably carvedilol, if you reach the peak dose of 25 milligram to 50 milligram BD, the cost might go higher. The pharmacokinetics also, compared to other beta blockers, mainly carvedilol, if you compare, is much better. The plasma half-life is longer, so you can use in OD dose. Absorption is much better, although it is similar to carvedilol. There is no first-pass effect. Bioavailability is very good compared to carvedilol, and protein binding is less. And therefore, the renal versus hepatic clearance is balanced. So this is the profile of the bisoprolol. 50% of the metabolism is converted to inactive metabolite and good plasma half-life, so you can use it for in a OD dose. And the clearance is half renal and half hepatic metabolism, which is converted to inactive metabolite, and that is also cleared renally. In a patient with renal dysfunction, unless it is a very severe renal dysfunction, beta blockers, which can be used safely, are metoprolol and bisoprolol. Carvedilol, you have to be very careful with in using in renal dysfunction patients. Metabolism, this I think we can skip. So no dose adjustment is necessary for mild to moderate liver or kidney impairment for bisoprolol. And daily dose maximum can be 10 milligram per day, even in patients with renal and liver dysfunction. Regarding erectile dysfunction, which is another common problem, and patients don't come out with it easily. So you have to be actually careful and explain to the patient when you give beta blocker. But fortunately, compared to enalapril and amlodipine, bisoprolol 5 mg per day has much less of this effect. But today only I got a patient who has got this complaint and I had to stop bisoprolol. I'm not sure whether that is the cause. Probably the diabetes is causing. So, but this is a common problem along with gynecomastia caused by MRA. These are very common problems. Aldecton causing gynecomastia and beta blockers causing some degree of erectile dysfunction, especially given along with ongoing chlorothalidone or hydrochlorothalidone, both of which are also having some impact on erectile dysfunction. This we already talked about, the 50-50 liver and renal clearance. Also, if the patient has got toxicity of beta blocker, say accumulation of beta blocker because of severe renal dysfunction, and the patient has continued the dosages, then it is moderately dialyzable. And therefore, rarely you require this. I have not seen a bisoprolol patient coming with a severe bradycardia problem. Typically, it is atenolol which is causing most of these problems. And in elderly population where atenolol is commonly used because it's a cheaper drug, used very commonly for hypertension still, although it has been removed from the hypertension treatment for elderly already. So I think we'll skip this. So although it's an old drug, it works like this. That is what probably apparently these slides are claiming. No adverse effect on lipid metabolism, no adverse effect on glucose metabolism. Much better than atenolol, of course, better 24-hour coverage, sustained BP control over long term. So once you are using for blood pressure also, the effect is long term. But again, as I said, it's only meant for early onset of hypertension systemic and younger population. And you don't get sudden changes of heart rate during exercise. So it is a preferred beta blocker for treatment of heart failure, for angina or ischemia, as well as for hypertension in certain categories of patients. So you can use it post-MI for hypertension with CAD, for hypertension with faster heart rates. Thank you. I think we'll stop there. Any questions is invited.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much for your nice and lucid presentations. Now, any questions from audience? Yes, either you can have an on chat box or you can ask to direct to our speaker.
Hello.
Right, sir. Sir, can you unmute yourself, sir? Dr. Devraj, you need to unmute yourself. Yes, sir.
Hello. I'm audible?
Yes, sir.
I'm Dr. Devraj Dholaria. My question is for the hypertension for the both renal prospective and the cardiac prospective. Suppose the patient they have a wide pulse pressure, systolic pressure is very so high. So how we can treat as per the nephrological perspective and the cardiological perspective?
So what I understand that what you are telling is a difference between diastolic and systolic. So we have to look the patient as a whole, whether the patient is elderly. Then secondly, one of the common causes is AR. So in elderly patient, you have to see whether it is AR. And usually in hypertension control, systolic blood pressure is given more importance. We have to see. And if the patient is elderly, then even we can allow blood pressure about 140, 150. It should not be very, very tight control if the diastolic is very, very low. Choice of antihypertensive is like same. We have to see whether there is any compelling indication. Like if your patient is diabetic, proteinuric, then obviously ACE inhibitor ARB is the first choice. Young patients, then definitely we can use some sort of beta blockers. So that is, it will totally depend on the patient's profile.
I got something to add to that. The kind of patient you are describing, sir, is basically elderly patient most of the time because of the stiff vessel, that is arteriosclerosis. The conductance vessels, the arteries are stiff. And in these patients, probably beta blockers, although this is a bench data, there is no clinical proof, but the pulse wave velocity is not affected by beta blockers. And the problem is that these patients, the pulsar travels, and then when it reflects back, it meets at the central aorta. And the central aortic BP is high. And the pulse pressure basically correlates strongly, not with atherosclerotic disease, not with renal dysfunction, but it correlates strongly with stroke and heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, LVH. So these two things strongly correlate. So in these patients, probably beta blocker are not to be used as a primary as an antihypertensive, although if there are other indications along with it, that is a different thing. There, the primary drugs to be used in elderly patients are ACE inhibitors, or first choice probably is calcium channel blocker and diuretic, and then ACE inhibitors. Or maybe most of these patients require a combination. The second thing which is to be emphasized strongly is that these patients have got sclerosed artery in the brain also. And if they keep dropping their BP posteriorly, repeatedly, there are micro infarcts in the brain which are silent. And so this is a major cause of multi-infarct dementia. So over the next 5 to 7 years, patients gradually starts losing cognitive function. And that is not easily recognizable. So if you are giving drugs to these patients for hypertension with this wide pulse pressure and stiff arteries, you have to make sure that you check postural hypertension at least intermittently. And that is tedious to do in the clinic. So if not, you can advise the patient to do it at home. Supine position for 10 minutes, relax. Check the BP and heart rate, make the patient stand up, and at 1 minute and again at 3 minutes, check the BP and heart rate. If the BP or heart BP drops more than 10 to 15%, or if the heart rate rises significantly, both of these are not good signs. And these patients, if you want to get the BP systolic down to 130, that might be dangerous. So if you feel that 150 is safer, leave it at 150 rather than getting it down, because you might be damaging the brain. And sometimes the patient has severe coronary artery disease, you might be damaging the heart also by causing ischemic episodes. So be very careful in these patients when using these drugs. Thank you.
Thank you. Good explanation.
Right, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Vasavada.
There was a question on the chat, I think, but I
yes, sir.
Read it. What is that?
Can we use bisoprolol in patients with sympathetic overactivity regardless of hypertension or cardiac condition, sir?
Of course. I mean, it's a logic that beta blockers are basically working against sympathetic overactivity. So straight away, if you have got a proof that this is sympathetic, so resting heart rate is high and the circulating volume is good, your pulse pressure is good, these are the patients where beta blockers will work for whatever reason you are giving.
Right, sir.
So we are using for anxiety also. A common combination is a propranolol with a clonazepam. This is a common combination. The reason is this only.
Right, sir. Yeah, any further questions, sir, from audience?
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Can you hear me? I'm Dr. Sayed, and I have one question for Dr. Siddharth and one for Dr. Vasavada.
Yes, sir. Please,
Dr. Siddharth, I just want to know, can you throw some light on calcium channel blocker, which has a anti-proteinuric effect. And Dr. Vasavada, can you tell me how far the beta blocker is useful with preserved ejection fraction?
So regarding the calcium channel blockers, we all know that dihydropyridines and non-dihydropyridines. So as far as anti-proteinuric effect is concerned, non-dihydropyridines are preferred, such as diltiazem. Okay, verapamil. So these are the calcium channel blockers. And so many times we are having diabetic or proteinuric patients in which we are not able to give first choices like ACE inhibitor or ARB, mostly for the reasons of hyperkalemia. Then these are the group of drugs. So we can use that. However, in addition to BP control and like a hypertensive effect, one thing specially which we need to see is heart rate. So whenever we are using verapamil or diltiazem, then combination with other drug like beta blocker, which decreases heart rate, we have to be very, very careful. But anti-proteinuric action is better as compared to other group of drug.
What about the clinidipine?
So, yeah. So it has been claimed like this is a triple channel blocker. So clindamycin, even the other CCBs, just like benedipin, etc., it has been claimed that they are also having some sort of anti-proteinuric action. However, we still don't have very hardcore long-term data regarding the efficacy of using them as an anti-proteinuric agent. So all these drugs, we just use an add-on. Whenever we are having full dose ACE inhibitor, ARB, still the patients is highly proteinuric. Or in other case, whenever patients are not tolerating, we are not able to give ACE inhibitor ARB, then we can use that.
I'll just, before answering Dr. Sayed's question, I'll ask another thing. What do you think about SGLT2 inhibitors as an anti-proteinuric agent? Is it likely to come into play in the long run, regardless of diabetes or HFRAS?
Yeah, so basically now there are more and more data of SGLT2 inhibitors, not only as an anti-proteinuric drug, but they are considered to be a drug which helps in retardation of progression of CKD. For so many years, we don't have any drugs which helps in retardation of progression of CKD, except for good control of DM, good control of hypertension. But these are the drugs which have actually proven that if we use that, then definitely that will help. So as an antiproteinuric, preservation of EGFR is better. And I think now over the last 1 year, 2 years, the usage of SGLT2 inhibitors is more and more high.
When I had attended a webinar by Dr. Murray, who is one of the primary investigators regarding SGLT2 inhibitor, and I had asked a question. This was an international webinar where all these studies which have been done for SGLT2 inhibitors, nowhere there is mentioned that how many patients are actually proteinuric, because it seems that only if there is proteinuria, it has got benefit. What about the kidney disease without proteinuria?
So now actually they have been decided, like we are having previously all these studies were excluding the patients with EGFR of less than 30. But with the some new data, I don't have exactly that data, but definitely there are some new data in which they are using patients with proteinuria and EGFR less than 30. And there are some like dapagliflozin has been used in, there was a daparenal trial, and some trials they have shown that it helps in preservation of EGFR and helps in prevention of data. And data definitely is there. In the subgroup of the patient, they have analyzed in which they have used patients with proteinuria, it is found to be useful.
Sir, Dr. Sayed, please repeat your question because I exactly forgot in this chakkar. Could you repeat the question, Dr. Sayed?
Yeah.
Hello.
The beta blocker in preserved ejection fraction.
Oh, yeah. So in preserved ejection fraction, what I used to believe till now, that most of these patients present with a normal or high blood pressure. And this is basically a ventriculo-arterial decoupling. What happens is that there is a higher systemic vascular resistance, and that tends to rise suddenly when the patient presents with acute decompensated heart failure in these cases. And they present very recurrently also. And the heart is not able to manage the sudden afterload. And because of that, there is back pressure and there is pulmonary edema. So if you see classic patient, the patient is an elderly lady with diabetes or without diabetes, usually with hypertension, longstanding, but sometimes not known. And the history is that patient has been had meal at 7:30 along with the family and was sitting and chatting in the drawing room, and 2 hours down the line, patient is in ICU on NIV or sometimes on invasive ventilator. So this is the sudden presentation, which is very typical in HFPF. Although there are patients who present with ambulatory class 3 failure also. And the mechanism is that there is sudden surge in systemic vascular resistance. The heart cannot match. And if you see this patient, the main treatment here is vasodilators. You have to reduce the systemic vascular resistance. So when the patient comes to in ICU, don't give too much of diuretic. You can give a single shot, but the actual volume, circulating volume is not high in these patients. So if you give aggressive diuretic, the next thing that will happen is after 3-4 hours, patient will improve. And after passing 1 liter of urine, patient will go into hypotension. And if you check the sonography again, you'll find that the filling pressure on both sides have gone low, and next morning's creatinine will be high. This is the typical situation of HFPF. So HFPF, the main treatment when the patient presents with ADHF is to give vasodilators mainly as treatment and minimize the diuretics. Then on the long run, what you can do, the best thing is to control the blood pressure well. beta blockers till now used to believe that by reducing the heart rate, you are reducing the load on the heart. But here, probably the heart rate doesn't come much into play at all. And therefore, the data, the recent data is that you don't bring down the heart rate too much when the patient has HFpEF as a basic problem. HFpEF, of course, is defined by presence of hypertrophy, presence of high E by E prime on sonography, increased LA volumes, and presence of pulmonary hypertension or confirmed raised BNP with this syndrome. If any three of these four are present, then you can define as HFpEF. So there's a specific definition. And beta blockers so should be used and not very liberally. Even I was using very aggressively beta blockers in patients with HFpEF, considering that heart rate control will help. But you don't control the heart rate too much in patients with HFpEF. Keep it around 80-85. Same goes for atrial fibrillation when patient is not ischemic or not having LV dysfunction. Again, the heart rate target should be around 80-90, not 60-70.
Any diastolic dysfunction, whether it improves with beta blocker or not in this patient?
No. There is no direct impact on the diastolic function improving.
Because they are having left ventricular hypertrophy and the increased LV filling pressure. And then in this patient, whether the diastolic dysfunction will improve with beta blocker or not?
No, because diastolic dysfunction can improve in two ways. Either by positive lucitropy, that is the active improvement of the active relaxation of the muscle. But beta blocker acts the other way around. It is a negative lucitropic agent. And the other way it can improve is by changing the compliance, which is a long run thing. Changing the compliance in the sense by either reducing afterload acutely, beta blocker doesn't reduce the systemic vascular resistance or the central aortic pressure. In fact, both of them is inferior to other antihypertensive drugs. At the same time, it has no impact on the myocardial remodeling. That is very important. Try to control the weight. If the weight is a major issue, then and there are recurrent events, the prognosis is bad, as bad as HFrEF, and probably you can seriously consider bariatric surgery, which might be one thing which might prove to be useful in certain type of patient. Those patients who are non-obese, nothing much you can do except to control the BP well, control the heart rate to a reasonable level, and strongly control the salt intake. Ask them to avoid soda bicarb specifically. That you have to mention separately. Especially soda backup, you have to mention cold drinks, you have to mention soda, you have to mention cooking soda, as well as Eno separately. Because if you tell soda, you know they don't consider soda. And most of these patients, typically, when they start getting the problem, they feel queasy in the abdomen or stomach and they take Eno. And that triggers the pulmonary edema. You have to specifically tell them that not to take Eno. Also, you have to tell them not to take NSAIDs over the counter, because these patients are of the age group where pains and aches are very common, joint pains, etc. And NSAIDs are given. So NSAIDs should be avoided. Right?
That's right. There is one new drug which has come up for hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy where
name I can't remember. Ampathy naam
jaya. That
it was just recently presented in ESC. Right?
That really helps in the diastolic dysfunction, I think, because it has direct effect on the myocytes.
Yeah, the actin myosin coupling is directly affected, basically.
Yeah, this new drug is really, it was discussed in the European Society of Congress of Cardiology. And I think there was a separate lecture for this new drug, and that I also forgot on the name, but anyway,
name from him.
Good promise for these people. Thank you.
Right, sir. Any further questions from audience? Okay.
Call it a day.
Right, sir. So on behalf of JB Chemical, on a World Heart Day, you all audience, including our speaker, you must have been treat your patients used to beat. So I once again wish you a very happy World Heart Day, and yes, thank you very much to be participate on this dais, sir. Thank you, sir.
Good night. Good night, everyone.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Good night. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Good night.